Today, 1st April, we will talk about another complex topic because we must switch to the two-dimensional flow, 2D flow, 2D flow. And I have to say that it is a little bit complex, in particular in terms of algebra that we need to write down today. So I ask a little bit of patience from you in order to follow and write the equation that governs the 2D flow. And in particular, I'd like to talk about the motivation that motivate the using of more complex equations in order to solve some practical applications when the two-dimensional features of the flow must be described by our model, our method. Then we need to write of the governing equation, governing equation, along with the needed boundary conditions, boundary conditions. And then just a few words about the numerical methods, needed to solve the governing equation. I switch to Italian. Quindi ragazzi, oggi vi devo chiedere un po' di pazienza perché dovremmo fare tanti conti per ricavare le equazioni che descrivono la bidimensionalità del flusso. Quindi vi prego di non distrarvi come dire, sui conti, ma teniamo sempre a mente dove vogliamo arrivare. E dove vogliamo arrivare è arrivare a scrivere delle equazioni che poi possiamo risolvere. E poi vi faccio anche osservare, vedremo anche come poi queste equazioni possono essere risolte proprio nella pratica. Quindi vi chiedo scusa in anticipo per la pesantezza della lezione di oggi. So I just said that today the lecture is a little bit heavy to follow because we need a lot of algebra in order to write the governing equation. So we need to make a lot of algebra. We need a lot of algebra in order to make the final form of the governing equations, actually, because we are in 2D, then we have not only one equation, but at least we will have at least three equations. The first one is the continuity equation, and then we need to write two momentum equations because we have to write the equation, the momentum equation along a direction and the other one along the perpendicular direction. So we need to make a lot of algebra in order to have to write the governing equation that in turn will be solved by means of numerical methods. Then it is very important to understand that what we need to do is useful for practical application. And to do this, I show you just an example here. And here on the left of this slide, you can see a kind of channel of river in which on the right we have a rather straight flank, whilst in the left side, in the left bank, we have a curve. So actually the water discharge flows into this river, but here we have a curve. So what we expect, and you can see here in the plot on the right, and in particular looking at these free surface distribution, I can write a kind of qualitative sketch. Think to a generic trapezoidal shape. If we have a curve into the river, of course the free surface cannot be horizontal. So the problem is important to describe the inclination, the slope, the transversal slope of the free surface when two-dimensional effects are important. Of course, the answer is yes. Indeed, if you look here in this part, you can see that the free surface actually, oh, sorry, I don't know if I can highlight it. If you look here, then we have a kind of inclination, It's too hard to draw. Okay, I try. So the problem is related to the fact that the free surface is not horizontal. Indeed, here we have a level higher than here. Then, of course, also the velocity is different. So here we have the left velocity, and here we have the right velocity. And it could be very important to address the problem of estimating the difference of velocity or the difference of water depth on the transversal, so this is left and this is right, and the differences in terms of water depth depending on the location within the transversal section. And of course, this difference, as you can see here, this difference is a kind of delta y, cannot be catched by one-dimensional model. So we need to employ a kind of 2D model. Of course, this is a 2D physics. But in order to catch this difference, we need to employ a 2D model. And as usual, we define a model as an equation or a set of equations, and then a method able to solve the equation. So just coming back to the blackboard, what is a model? Very basically, we need equations that we usually called governing equation. Then we need of boundary conditions, then we need to understand if we can simplify the equations, and once done, we need to solve them, the solution. And usually we resort to two kinds of methods. The first one are analytical, and the second one is numerical. In the case of two-dimensional flow, the analytical methods are not useful for practical application, because it is true that analytical methods can be employed for the resolution of the governing equations, but only for a series of ideal cases. So usually we need of numerical methods. So what we have to do today? We need to write the equations. We need to write the boundary conditions. We need to understand if we can simplify the equations. And after some algebra, we need to understand if somebody suggests us a kind of numerical methods able to solve the equation. In a general case, or better, in a ideal case, we can think about this kind of problem. The problem could be something like this. You can, okay? So we have a river in which a water discharge is flowing, and this water discharge can be also a function of the time. So actually we are talking about transient flow. So we will write a very general form of the governing equation in the 2D cases, in the 2D case. Just in this case, we have the velocity that occurs into this domain, just for example in this boundary. Actually, this is the upstream boundary. Then the flow starts to occur, and of course, if you think about the qualitative features of the flow, here we could have a kind of vortex occurring here, a kind of vortex. Indeed, it could be expected that here the velocity, there is an area in which the velocity is almost equal to zero, not exactly equal to zero, but almost equal to zero. And also here the velocity tends to spread on the wall width of the downstream part of the river. And then we can understand that here the flow is not 1D. In order to describe this physics, and it could be very important to describe this physics, and now I try to convince you about that. In order to describe this physics, we need again a 2D model, of course. Just for example, why we need a 2D model? Why it is so important to describe this area in which the velocity is rather small if compared to the main channel? Just for example, here we can have sedimentation. So just in case in which this river is used as a port, as a harbor, this area should be forbidden to the mooring of boat. So we need to identify if a problem of sedimentation, of silting, or siltation, this is another word that we can use to refer to the increasing of the bed level. I can show you, just again going in Google Earth, by looking again to the river of our region, to the coast of course, in which usually the river are used as a harbor, just as in these cases. And as you can see here, as you can see, the water depth is very low. But why? As you can see here, the flow occurs usually into the central part of the section, whilst in these areas, here and here, you have a very small velocity, and then the sediments are allowed to go to the bottom, and then the elevation of the bottom increases. Then it is very important to get the features of the flow in order to understand if the configuration can be modified in order to limit this problem of sediment siltation. Quindi il problema di riprodurre questo effetto, che avrete capito anche se l'ho detto in inglese, che è legato alla bidimensionalità del flusso, può essere molto importante anche da un punto di vista pratico. Infatti vi ho fatto vedere un caso a noi vicino, che è quello del Pescara. Vedete, questo praticamente è un allargamento, e appena la sezione si allarga, come vedete qui c'è una zona di sedimentazione, quindi è molto importante quantomeno capire quello che succede, anche per ottimizzare la configurazione. Ad esempio, questa transizione può essere stata studiata anche in funzione di questo fenomeno. Qui ad esempio vediamo che c'è un'altra area di sedimentazione, another area of siltation. Also in this case related to the two-dimensional features of the flow. And here is the areas, the main channel, in which the flow occurs. We can also, I don't know if you are able to see this part, in which also to the sea, the bottom elevation increased during the time due to the particular two-dimensional features of the flow. As you can see here, we have an area in which the water depth is very low. We can try to show a series of historical images just to understand if it is possible to see better this problem. No. So here you go. I don't know if you are able to see that this area is characterized by a low values of the water depth. Then it could be very dangerous for the navigation. So the boats can navigate with a low level of safety. So also in this case it is very important to address the problem relating to the two-dimensional features of the flow. So in a few words, I can say that two-dimensional model in some cases is important. Then we cannot resort to 1D model. So usually the 1D models in general, so the models that we have studied so far, the normal flow, the transient flow, the gradual varied flow in the 1D context, could be useful, but not always. In some cases we need to resort to 2D models. Just for instance, the problem that we said just before. So say that we need to write down the equation that is are the equations that are able to describe the two-dimensional features of the flow. So as usual, we need to resort to the continuity equation. One is the continuity equation, and the momentum equation. The first difference with respect to the 1D model, that in this case we have not only one equation but at least two equations. First of all, we need to define our reference frame. So we need to write down a kind of reference frame. So this is X, this is Y, and this is Z. So Z is the vertical direction. Vertical direction. In other words, I'm saying that the zeta direction is the same of g. So the gravitational acceleration is a vector with this component. So the vector g, the gravity acceleration, of course the acceleration is a vector, has two zero components along x and y, and as a negative component along the vertical direction zeta. So actually we define the vertical direction with respect to the gravity acceleration. So in turn, the plane, this is the origin of the reference frame, the plane OXY, XY, is the horizontal plane, horizontal plane. So on one end we have the zeta that is directed along the vertical, then the plane defined by the reference frame XY is the horizontal plane. So we need to define, we need to write the equations, so both the continuity equation and momentum equations, within this reference frame. But what it means that we need to solve the flow feature? It means that we need to achieve, to search for a solution for the velocity, so the generic vector that is the velocity, v vector of course, and also a value of the pressure. So when we dealing with a generic flow, when we want to solve, to understand how the flow is evolving, it means that we need to understand how the velocity vector and the pressure evolves in time and is distributed in the space. So actually we need to answer to this question. V as a function of x, y, z and t. And of course the scalar pressure as a function of x, y, z and t. Actually this is a 3D model. 3D model. Then we need to simplify our equation in order to resort to a 2D model that is more simple to solve. Then we have a lot of things to do. We need, first of all, to write the equations in a three-dimensional cases. Then we need to make some hypotheses in order to switch to the two-dimensional model. What I mean when I say two-dimensional model? That in this case, the velocity is not a function of the vertical direction. Of course, the pressure is a function of the zeta, of course. As you can imagine, you can guess that if you go close to the bottom, of course the pressure is higher with respect to the pressure acting on the free surface. So the pressure changes with the elevation. But the velocity can be the variation of the velocity along the vertical direction can be neglected. So actually if I If we write equations that neglect the variation of the velocity along the vertical direction, we switch from 3D model to 2D model. These are generic words about the model, but we need to understand that also the 2D model is a simplification of the real world. So the 1D model is a simplification of the real world that could be useful in some cases. The 2D model is a more complex model with respect to the 1D one, but again, it is a simplified model because the real model, the model that is able to describe the reality, is a three-dimensional model. So again, I'm saying that the 2D model is a simplification of the reality. What we have to do? We have to start from the basic equation. And the basic equation, actually, is that the divergence of the velocity is equal to zero. Prego. Assolutamente sì, assolutamente sì. Niente. Dicevo, quando vi dico che i modelli bidimensionali sono necessari perché non sempre quelli monodimensionali sono sufficienti, in realtà dobbiamo sottolineare che anche i modelli bidimensionali sono una semplificazione. Infatti, nella realtà, risolvere un flusso che cosa vuol dire? Vuol dire prendere un punto, qualsiasi, nello spazio fluido ovviamente, quindi in acqua, nel nostro caso particolare, e conoscere con esattezza qual è l'evoluzione temporale della velocità. Quindi vuol dire che se io prendo un qualsiasi punto nello spazio, che è identificato le sue coordinate x, y, z, io so conoscere per ogni istante quanto vale la velocità, intesa come vettore, se ci pensate. Intesa come vettore. La stessa cosa dobbiamo farlo per la pressione, cioè in quel punto dobbiamo conoscere anche la pressione, quindi per un qualsiasi generico punto e per un qualsiasi istante. Quindi nella sostanza, conoscere le caratteristiche di un flusso vero, reale, è quello di rispondere alla domanda quanto vale il vettore velocità e quanto vale la pressione. Ovviamente questo è un problema tridimensionale, non bidimensionale. Quindi per passare dal tridimensionale, che è la verità, al bidimensionale, che è una semplificazione, dobbiamo fare alcune ipotesi. Quindi è vero che il 2D è più complicato dell'1D, ma anche il 2D è una semplificazione. Quindi già vi aspettate, cosa che non faremo, che in alcuni casi, a dire la verità molto particolari, addirittura si deve ricorrere a dei modelli tridimensionali, che è tutto molto più complicato. Ho risposto più o meno al tuo dubbio? È tutto chiaro? Niente, niente. Then we need to resort to the real equation. So we need to write the continuity equation. Continuity equation. And also, of course, for incompressible in, or if you want, for solenoidal flow. So, solenoidal flow. So, in the case in which the density does not change as a result of the pressure fluctuations. So, the density is constant. Then the continuity equation can be written as the divergence of the vector velocity is equal to zero. But also we need to resolve the moment, to write down the momentum equation. And as you understand, we have three momentum equations. The first one is along x, the second one along y, and the third one along zeta. And I write, I hope, only this one. We can write the famous Navier-Stokes equation. So we need to write this equation plus, sorry, plus fu the u in the y plus fu the u in the zeta is equal to minus 1 over rho the p the x plus the terms related to the viscosity. And in the same way, we can write also the momentum equation along the y direction. So here we have the v in the x plus v in the y plus w the v in the zeta is equal minus 1 over rho the p in the y plus mu over rho the Laplacian of the Laplacian of v, and this is rho, and at the end the v the t plus u the x plus v the y plus v the zeta equal minus 1 over rho the p in the zeta minus g, because along zeta also the gravitational acceleration, the gravity acceleration acts, plus mu over rho nabla of v. But what are u, v, and w? Is the component of the velocity. So the velocity can be written as a vector with this component. Actually, this is the transpose of this vector. So the horizontal component along the x-axis is equal to u. The horizontal component along the y-axis is v. The vertical component of the vector velocity is w. So coming back here, actually this velocity has three components. The first one is this one along x, the second one is along y, and the third one is along zeta. So we have three components. So actually here it seems that we have two unknowns. Actually we have four. We have the three components of the velocity and the scalar that express the pressure. So we have four unknown. And of course in the simplified case in which the flow is solenoidal. Otherwise we could have also another unknown, that is the density, but in this case the density is constant, so this value is known, of course is 1000 kilogram per cubic meter for the water, actually for fresh water. So we need to solve this equation and the momentum equation, okay? And we need to simplify this equation. So we need to start from the first one and then switch to the momentum equations. So a lot of work has to be done. But before to start to the resolution, at least up to the point in which we can resolve them, of the equations, we need to spend some words about the boundary conditions. Quindi queste sono le equazioni di continuità, che è la prima, e queste altre tre che sono le condizioni, le equazioni di conservazione della quantità di moto. Non mi stancherò mai di dire non la chiamate equazione del momento, perché quella è la traduzione in inglese, dove si chiamano le momentum equation. Quindi queste sono le ultime tre, sono le equazioni di conservazione della quantità di moto lungo x, lungo y, lungo z. Quindi quello che dobbiamo fare adesso è risolverle. Come vedete, non sarà facile risolverle. Addirittura arriveremo ad un certo punto e ci dovremmo fermare. E in dove ci fermeremo entrerà in gioco il metodo numerico. Però dobbiamo renderle risolvibili con il metodo numerico. Quindi se volete, il lavoro che dobbiamo fare adesso è scrivere le equazioni, semplificarle fino a che accettiamo di semplificarle e arrivare ad una forma che possa essere risolta con un metodo numerico. Questa un po' è la strategia che dobbiamo seguire. E come vedete, le incognite non sono due, come sembrava prima, velocità e pressione, ma qui sono quattro, perché sono le tre componenti della velocità e la pressione. È soltanto perché abbiamo preso in considerazione un fluido incomprimibile, o se volete un flusso solenoidale, perché altrimenti avremmo avuto un'ulteriore incognita che sarebbe stata la densità. Ma in questo caso prendo la densità un parametro che quindi è uguale a 1000 kg al metro cubo, quantomeno per l'acqua dolce. So, the strategy is to simplify the equations a lot of algebra up to a point in which the equations can be numerically solved. Numerically solved. So, we need to fill these dots. We need to perform some algebra in order to simplify the governing equations and write them in a form that can be useful for a numerical resolution. But first, we need to define the boundary conditions, at least from a theoretical point of view. So, first of all, we need to understand which are the boundaries. So, of course, I try to write down a kind of 3D. So, you can imagine that this is the bottom. This is the bottom. And here we have the free surface. Here we have the free surface. Free surface. So we need to solve what is happening between these two surfaces. So the bottom can be written as remember, this is zeta, this is y, and this is x. Okay? So the bottom is a function can be described by this function. So the zeta, so the elevation, is a function of x and y, not of the time. So the bottom is intended as fixed in time. So we are not dealing with movable bed. In another form, we can write this surface in this way, of course. On the other hand, we have the free surface, but in more or less the same form, we can write this. In this case, the elevation of this free surface is called zeta w, and also in this case, this function is a function of this elevation is a function, of course, of the coordinate of the point x and y, but also of the time, because the free surface can evolve during the time. And again, this boundary can be described by this function. So we have a function that describes the free surface and a function that describes the bottom. Both of them can be written in general as f x y z t is equal to zero. This is the general form of a boundary. Both in either movable or fixed, because we have retained the dependence from the elapsed time. So for the free surface, we have that f is equal to zeta minus zeta w x y t is equal to zero. That in this case, f is a function of x, y, of course, z and t equal to zero. For the bottom, we have that f is equal zeta minus zeta bottom as a function of x and y is equal to zero. Then in this case, the function does not depend from the time. So if you want, this is simple if compared to the first one. In general, if you think about the physics, the velocity here can be only tangent to the surface. So if this is the velocity, or if here you have the velocity is always tangent. Or if you want, the normal component to the free surface, to the surface is always zero. So this is a kind of boundary condition in terms of velocity. So this boundary condition is aimed to describe the kinematics of the problem. Indeed, if the velocity is always tangent to the surface, actually, the surface is a streamline of the flow, because the flow cannot enter into the surface. This kind of boundary condition is usually referred to as slip condition, because if we neglect what is happening within the boundary layer, the velocity is tangential. If we go into the boundary layer, the velocity is zero within at the surface. But if we are outside the boundary layer, the velocity can be tangential to the surface. Quello che vi sto dicendo è che dal punto di vista intuitivo, la velocità sulla superficie, è più facile vederla sul fondo, è tangenziale al fondo. Questo vuol dire che la componente normale è uguale a zero, perché l'acqua non può entrare nella superficie, perché altrimenti non sarebbe un contorno. Quindi stiamo prendendo in considerazione un fondo impermeabile, an impervious surface, an impervious boundary. Quindi, come vedete, le informazioni che vengono descritte da queste condizioni a contorno sono di tipo cinematico. Quindi parliamo di condizioni a contorno cinematico. In questo caso si parla di slip condition. In italiano non so come potrebbe essere tradotto, forse condizione di scivolamento. Slip vuol dire scivolare. Perché ci mettiamo fuori dallo strato limite? Adesso, senza entrare nei dettagli idraulici in cui non voglio entrare, però voi sapete che in teoria, o forse potrei dire anche in pratica, se noi ci mettiamo vicino, 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 vicino alla superficie, In particolare sulla superficie la velocità è uguale a zero, o meglio, è uguale a quella della superficie. Però noi rinunciamo a vedere quello che succede così vicino alla superficie, nel cosiddetto strato limite, ma ci mettiamo appena fuori. E appena fuori la velocità non può che essere tangenziale perché l'acqua non riesce ad entrare nel contorno. Then we are talking about a kinematic boundary condition. Kinematic boundary condition. And hereinafter we refer to the kinematic boundary condition with this acronym. KBC stands for kinematic boundary condition. So this is the code of kinematic boundary condition. And the kinematic boundary condition is aimed to describe that the boundary is a streamline. In other words, the function, the material derivative of the function that describes the boundary is equal to zero. Or if you want, the local acceleration of the boundary plus the horizontal component times the derivative of f along x plus v, the derivative with respect y, plus f the zeta is equal to zero. This is the generic form of the kinematic boundary condition. So what we have to do now? We need to write this one for the free surface and for the bottom. It is possible to demonstrate that this formulation is equivalent to say that Vn is equal to zero. You can try by yourself, but it is not so complex if you remember that the gradient of the function f is a function, is a vector that is perpendicular to the surface. But you can try if you want. So we need to write the kinematic boundary condition at the free surface. This is the free surface kinematic boundary condition. F is equal to zeta minus zeta w, that is a function of x, y, and t, and this is equal to zero. Now we need to write the f, the t, plus u, the f in the x plus v the f in the y plus v the w the f in the zeta is equal to zero. Now the f in the t, zeta is an independent variable, so the only variation with respect to the time is related to the variation of the free surface elevation. So here we can write minus the temporal variation of the free surface elevation plus u, of course, again the spatial derivative along x is related only to the free surface elevation. Again, v, the variation of the free surface elevation with respect to y. Again, I make an error because here we have minus, because here we have a minus, plus v times the derivative of f with respect to zeta, and the derivative of f with respect to zeta is equal to 1, equal to 0. This is true at the freezer phase, not everywhere, only on the freezer phase. So this velocity is the horizontal velocity on the freezer phase, the vertical velocity on the freezer phase, the horizontal component V on the freezer phase, the vertical component on the freezer phase. Of course, zeta V is the freezer phase. Then, this relation, this boundary condition is saying that the vertical velocity is related to the acceleration of the freezer phase elevation plus these terms, d zeta w with respect to x plus v at the freezer phase, the derivative of the freezer phase elevation with respect to y. And this is true only at the freezer phase. But this is true. So this is our first boundary condition at the freezer phase, and this is the kinematic freezer phase boundary condition. And this is the slide 10, so we need to remember for the algebra that is expecting us. Then we need to write the bottom kinematic boundary condition. And the bottom kinematic boundary condition is almost the same when f is equal to zeta minus zeta bottom, in this case, as a function of x and y. X and y, as you can see, the time is missing now because b, the bottom, is fixed in time. Again, we need to write this relationship, that is the generic form of the kinematic boundary condition. V def in the zeta is equal to zero. Now, f is constant over the time. So the first derivative is equal to zero plus u. The derivative with respect to x is the derivative of zeta b with respect to x. And again, we need to switch to a minus because here we have the minus. So u, the zeta of the bottom with respect to x, minus v, the derivative of the elevation of the bed with respect to y, plus w times the derivative of this function with respect to zeta, that is equal to 1. And again, this is equal to the bottom. This is true at the bottom, not everywhere. So this is, of course, the velocity at the bottom, the velocity at the bottom, the vertical velocity at the bottom. So again, this boundary condition is able to provide us with a relationship valid only at the bottom. And this is the kinematic bottom boundary condition. Then it is true not everywhere, but only at the bottom. Just to understand, I use this symbol to indicate hat. This is a very old symbol using to say hat. In corrispondenza di, non tutti lo sanno, ma questo non viene dalle email, ma vuol dire at, cioè si dice at, cioè in corrispondenza di. Quindi che cosa abbiamo scritto in questa slide 10, in questa lavagna 10 e lavagna 11? Abbiamo particolarizzato le condizioni al contorno, questa è quella generale. Abbiamo scritto la funzione che descrive la condizione, la superficie libera, e abbiamo ottenuto che le velocità sulla superficie libera non sono qualsiasi, Ma note le componenti orizzontali e noto come cambia il contorno nel tempo, la velocità verticale deve assumere, o meglio, assume un valore ben preciso che è dato da questa relazione. Alla stessa maniera, se scriviamo, particolarizziamo la condizione a contorno di tipo cinematico per il fondo, otteniamo questa condizione a contorno. So, actually, if we come back here, we have these three equations, one, two, three, sorry, four equations, and these two boundary conditions. Actually, we are not looking at this boundary, because also these are the vertical boundaries, if you want. But we can, just for now, take into account an infinite domain case. So actually, the only boundary condition is that the solution is finite if we are very far from this point. So actually, the boundary condition, these boundary conditions, just for now, suffice to solve the problem. So now we need to solve. We need, or if you want to make some algebra on the governing equations, in order to simplify them, then in order to solve them by means of a numerical model, or better, method. So, first of all, we start with the continuity equation. So, we write again the divergence of V is equal to zero, that actually can be written in this way, the summation of the spatial derivative of the velocity component is equal to zero. Now, we are not interested in the three-dimensional features of the flow. So actually, we don't need to solve the whole continuity equation, but we can simplify this equation by integrating along the vertical direction. So, when I say that we want to simplify this equation, I mean that I integrate the equation. This equation is valid everywhere. We want to integrate this equation along the vertical direction in order to get an equation that is valid again everywhere, but not taking into account the elevation at which we are looking at. So if I write this is y, this is x, and this is zeta, I don't want to know the velocity at every elevation, but knowing a kind of average velocity along the vertical suffices to me. Quello che vi sto dicendo è che io non voglio risolvere il problema tridimensionale, ma voglio conoscere una sorta di velocità media sulla verticale. Quindi io non voglio conoscere cosa succede, come sono diverse le cose lungo la verticale, ma voglio sapere come sono diverse le cose lungo il piano. Quindi io voglio, I want to know a kind of mean velocity that is equal to 1 over the local water depth integrated between the elevation of the bottom and the elevation of the free surface of U the zeta. This is a definition of the so-called depth averaged velocity. So, as you can guess, I'm not interested in the local component, but I'm interested in the depth averaged local velocity. So, this velocity is not a function of zeta. This is a function of x, y, and of course t. Whilst the local velocity is a function of x, y, zeta t. So I am not interested in the dependence of zeta. The only thing that I am interested in is the depth averaged velocity, that is a function of the point defined into the plane, the horizontal plane, without taking into account what is happening along the vertical direction. Quindi siamo interessati non più alla velocità locale, because if we look at the local velocity, actually we are talking about a three-dimensional model, and up to now we want to build a two-dimensional model. So this is the first point to pay attention to. In order to use, prego. L'H. H. Of course, this is the water depth. This is the water depth, in order to define the average value of the local velocity along the vertical. So just to have a sketch, to draw a sketch. Prego. Certo. Orizzontale però, non verticale. Ok. Niente. So we are interested in what is happening along the horizontal plane. So this is y and this is x. We are not interested in the profile along the vertical. So if we have this one, this is z, this is a generic point x, y. In the reality, if here we have the bottom, another plane here, actually here the velocity will be something like that. Okay, so this is the velocity. So this is u, x, y, z, but also at a generic instant t. We are not interested in this aspect. We are only interested in the mean value of the velocity. So, as you can understand, our results will be the depth averaged. So, this is U is equal to 1 over H integrated over the water column. And H is the local water depth. Again, the local water depth is a function of x, y, and t, because h is the difference between the elevation of the bottom, this is zb, that is a function of x and y, and the elevation of the free surface, that is a function of x, y, and t. So actually, h, that is the water depth, is a function of x, y, and t, because it is equal to the difference of the elevation of, we can write better, because it is the difference between the free surface evolution, that is a function of the space and the time, or better, is a function of the location on the horizontal plane and the time, minus the elevation of the bottom, that is a function of the point along the horizontal plane, but is not a function of the time. Okay, so we are interested not in the three-dimensional feature of the flow, but in the two-dimensional feature of the flow, along the horizontal plane. Horizontal plane. Indeed, this kind of model usually are referred to as 2DH. So they are two-dimensional model along the horizontal plane. So this H stands for horizontal plane. So the results, just understand, will be a distribution of velocity along the horizontal plane. We don't know what is happening along the vertical direction, but we know what is happening along the horizontal plane. Quello che vi sto dicendo è che non siamo interessati a quello che succede sulla verticale, ma non perché non siamo interessati, perché sarebbe troppo complicato. Vuol dire risolvere l'equazione di Navier-Stokes, l'equazione di continuità scritta in questa maniera. Che si fa? Ma primo, ci vuole tanto tempo, e tanto tempo vuol dire tanti soldi. Secondo, non sempre è necessario. Quindi non è, noi siamo interessati ad un fenomeno, allora usiamo il modello più sofisticato che esiste. Modello più sofisticato che esiste costa, per quanto mi riguarda non vuol dire comprare il programma, ma vuol dire tempo di calcolo, vuol dire costruzione della griglia, vuol dire tante cose. Quindi se non ce n'è bisogno, usiamo un modello bidimensionale. Il modello bidimensionale in questo caso, che è quello che ci interessa, è quello di rispondere alla domanda come cambia la velocità e come cambia la profondità in funzione di un punto definito su un piano. Quindi immaginatevi di vedere il problema in pianta e quindi in ogni punto di questa pianta avete un vettore di velocità e un valore della profondità. Questa è la soluzione. So the actual solution that we are looking at is a value of the horizontal component U as a function of x, y, and t. The depth averaged value of the other component as a function x, y, and t, and the value of the water depth as a function of x, y, and t. So if we make a kind of plan view, so this is a kind of river, we are looking, we will be able to take a point and we will be able to compute the component of the vector velocity along the x-axis. This is x and this is y. The component, the horizontal component of the velocity along y, and the value in this point of the water depth. This is, of course, a plan view. And this is a 2DH model. So we are trying to build a 2DH model that can be translated, can be viewed as a model aimed to describe the flow in plain view, in a plain view. Quindi, nella sostanza, se noi volessimo definire che cos'è un modello 2DH, è un modello il cui risultato può essere restituito con una pianta. Capite che il modello monodimensionale non poteva dare questi risultati. Non poteva dare questi risultati semplicemente perché l'unica variabile, o meglio, le uniche variabili spaziali che prendevamo in considerazione era la scissa curvilinea che correva lungo il fondo dell'alveo. In questo caso invece possiamo chiederci quanto vale la velocità, quanto vale la profondità un po' ovunque in pianta. E these values, U and V, are depth averaged. Depth averaged. So, this information are not complete because we don't know how the velocity changes with the vertical elevation. Okay? So, this is what we want. Now, what it means that we want to resolve the problem in the horizontal plane, that we can integrate along the vertical direction the equations. So, starting from the continuity equation, we need, sorry, I switch to white. We need to perform this integration in the zeta, of course, plus the integral from the bottom elevation up to the free surface elevation of this derivative. Sorry. This is the V plus the integral between the bottom elevation zeta V, the zeta, equal to zero. Now we need to solve this equation. So we can write this one as 1, this one as 2, and this one as 3. So we need to have three blackboards, the first one, the second one, and the third one. The third one is aimed to write this one, U, the zeta. This one is the integral zeta b zeta w, the second one was y the zeta is equal, and this one is zeta of the bottom, zeta of the free surface elevation, u in the x, the zeta equal. So we need to solve this one, and this one. Let's start from this. This is very simple because we have a derivative with respect to zeta and an integration with respect to zeta. So this is the free surface, sorry, the vertical velocity along the zeta direction between zeta b and zeta v, that is equal to the v at the free surface minus the v at the bottom. But we have written this one. We know what is the vertical velocity, or better, the vertical component of velocity at the free surface. Indeed, we can write the first one as the time derivative of the free surface elevation plus the component U at the free surface times the derivative of the free surface elevation with respect to x plus v free surface zeta w y. Plus, and this is the vertical component of the free surface that we have before obtained by applying the kinematic free surface boundary condition. And in the same way, we have also the results of the boundary condition at the bottom. So again, we need to write minus u at the bottom, the zeta bottom with respect to x, minus v at the bottom, the zeta bottom with respect to y. So this one, the third part, is equal to this. 3 is equal to this. And we can use, so we need to use this relationship within the continuity equation. Then we need to solve this one. Now we need to recall a rule that is called Leibniz rule. I don't know if you have studied this rule in some past course, but in very simple way, we can write if I have we can write zeta as a function of x, zeta 1, zeta 2 as a function of x, of a function, and this is d zeta, this is equal to the integral of zeta 1 x, zeta 2 x, the x, the zeta. So we can move the derivative inside the integral, but we need to write u computed in zeta 2 for the zeta 2 x minus u computed in zeta 1 the zeta 1 in the x. This is a simple rule. So if we want to move the derivative inside the integral, we need to take into account also the variation of the limit of the integral. Okay? So we can, and then we stop just a second, we can write that the derivative with respect to x, zeta b, zeta w, the u, theta, the zeta, is equal to the integral between zeta b, zeta w, the derivative of u with respect to x, the zeta, plus u at the free surface times the derivative of the free surface elevation with respect to x plus minus the u at the bottom here times the derivative of the bottom elevation with respect to x. As this is 1, we can go here, this is 1, we can write that the integral between zeta b, zeta w, of the derivative with respect to x in the zeta is equal to the in the x integral zeta b, zeta w, u the zeta, that is this one, minus ufs the zeta w the x plus u at the bottom the zeta bottom the x. But do you remember the definition of the mean The depth averaged velocity, we can look here. This is the definition of the mean, or better, the depth averaged velocity. So, zeta b, the integral of zeta, from zeta b up to the elevation of the free surface of u the zeta, is the mean velocity, the depth averaged velocity, times the water depth. So this one, this one, only without the derivative, this one is equal to the depth averaged velocity times the water depth. So this relationship can be written as the integral between the bottom elevation of the u x zeta is equal to, this one is the spatial, the derivative with respect to x of the depth averaged velocity times the water depth, minus UFS, the derivative of elevation of the free surface with respect x, plus the component along x of the velocity at the bottom, the zeta bottom, and this is, actually we can erase this one, this is 1. So we get the result in terms of 1. With the same algebra, we can get also this one. So 2 is equal, we can resort to here, is equal to the derivative with respect to y of VH. V is the depth averaged velocity, or better, is the component along y of the depth averaged velocity, minus the velocity v at the free surface, the derivative of the free surface elevation with respect to y, in this case, plus vb, zeta b, and the y. And this is the last result. So we need to insert this one, and this one into the continuity equation, this equation. Let's try, and then we stop. Dx UH minus U is a phase the zeta W dx plus U bottom the zeta bottom over the derivative with respect to x plus, and this is 1, this is 2, VH minus VFS the zeta V in the y plus VB the zeta B in the y plus, we need the last term. The last term is this one. So we have the free surface kinematic boundary condition and the bottom boundary condition with the sign switched. So we come back where here, plus the zeta V the T plus U at the free surface the zeta V the x plus V fs d zeta v dy minus u at the bottom d zeta bottom in the x minus v bottom d zeta bottom in the y is equal to 0. And we are lucky because this one and this one are the same. Then this one and this one are the same. Then this one and this one are the same. And finally, this one and this one are the same. Then the final continuity equation is, sorry, we can write in the zeta w the t plus the x u h plus the y v h is equal to 0. But better if zeta w is equal to zeta bed plus h, the zeta w in the with respect to the time is equal, the bed is fixed, then we have the h in the t. So the final, the very final this one, okay, this one, the very final equation is the h in the time plus the x u h plus the u, sorry, v h v h dy is equal to 0. This is our continuity equation within the frame of 2dh model. So this is the 2dh continuity equation. So this is the first equation, actually the simplest one if compared to the momentum equation. So this is our first result in terms of the continuity equation. And now we can stop some minutes. I said, please forgive me for this large quantity of computation of algebra that we need to do, but it is important that you pay attention to the core of the topic, so the physics interpretation of the equations, instead of directly on the algebra that we need to use for reaching, for achieving the equations themselves. So, as we have said, up to now we have obtained the continuity equation within the frame of 2dh models. Now we need to switch to the momentum equation. And just some blackboards. Okay, not this one, not this one. So the equation that we need to solve, okay, are this one. We have done only this one in a hour and a half. Then we need to solve these three. First of all, I want to address your attention to the zeta momentum equation. Indeed, as we are talking about a 2dh model,
Actually, we don't need to solve the zeta momentum equation, so the momentum equation written along the vertical direction. Actually, we need to respect also this equation, even if we are within the frame of 2dH model. So what I'm trying to do, to say, is that we need to understand which information can be obtained from the solution of the momentum equation written along the vertical direction. So we try to rewrite it, and we can write something like that. So we rewrite it, u the w the y plus u the w the z is equal minus g minus 1 over rho the derivative of p along zeta plus the viscous effect. Now, why we can use a 2dH approach to solve the problem, to describe the problem? Because actually we are taking into account again the case of gradual varied flow. Gradual varied flow. So these hypotheses, varied flows, these hypotheses must be applied also in the case of two-dimensional flows. In this case, we can say that the total derivative of the vertical component of the velocity can be neglected, and also the variation, so the second derivative of the vertical component of the velocity, can be neglected. These hypotheses can be translated in an analytical way by imposing that the total derivative of the vertical component of velocity can be neglected, and also this term can be neglected. Then, actually, the momentum equation along the vertical direction is very simple, because we can write minus g minus 1 over rho the p the zeta is equal to 0, because we can neglect all these terms, and this term is this one, and also we can neglect this one because we have this one. So actually the momentum equation along the vertical direction is very simple. We can simplify a lot this equation, and from this simplification we can write that 1 over rho the p the zeta is equal to minus g. Indeed, we can write the equation here. Now we need to integrate again. Integration along the vertical. Now we can integrate between the bottom elevation and a generic elevation. So we can write this one, the p, the zeta is equal to minus zeta p zeta g the zeta. Now, here again the integration is not so complex, so we can write 1 over rho the pressure between zeta b and zeta is equal to minus it is simple to write this one instead of integrate between zeta b and zeta, we integrate between zeta and zeta w. Zeta and zeta w is the same. Zeta and zeta w. Zeta, and we can solve also this integral, minus g zeta between zeta and zeta w. Then rho can be written here, so we can have the pressure at the free surface minus the pressure at the given elevation is equal to minus rho g zeta w minus zeta, and of course the pressure acting on the free surface is zero, then p zeta is equal to rho g zeta w minus zeta. Now we can use this relationship by, I rewrite here, p zeta is equal to rho g zeta w minus zeta. We can compute the derivative of p with respect to x and the derivative of p with respect to y, and here we have rho and g that are parameters, the derivative with respect to x of zeta w minus zeta. Now zeta is a parameter when we perform the derivative with respect to x, then this one is equal to rho g, the derivative of the elevation of the free surface elevation with respect to x, and again the derivative with respect to g is the zeta w in the y. Pay attention to this aspect. Actually, this is the solution of the zeta momentum equation. So actually, we were able to solve the momentum equation written along the vertical direction by imposing that the flow is gradual varied. So the solution of this momentum equation is simple if this hypothesis apply. Then this is the solution. And why of the zeta momentum equation? But why we've written these derivatives? Because if we look at this one, okay, we need here. So we can write, instead of the pressure, the derivative of the free surface elevation. So when the flow is gradual varied, the pressure is hydrostatic, and we can use, instead of the pressure, the free surface elevation. This is the big deal. Quindi capite che se io ipotizzo che il flusso sia gradualmente variato, posso risolvere esplicitamente l'equazione di conservazione della quantità di moto lungo la direzione verticale, che tradotto vuol dire che invece della pressione, io posso prendere in considerazione la posizione, l'elevazione della superficie libera. Quindi vedete che quando c'è l'ipotesi di moto gradualmente variato, nella realtà io posso usare invece della pressione l'elevazione della superficie libera, e quindi la pressione sparisce, perché la pressione è distribuita idrostaticamente, e se è distribuita idrostaticamente conosco la profondità, la posizione della superficie libera, allora posso conoscere anche la pressione. Quindi l'una vale l'altra, soltanto nell'ipotesi di moto gradualmente variato. Now we can remember that the free surface elevation is equal to can be written as the bottom elevation plus the water depth measured along the vertical direction. Then d zeta v dx is equal to the slope of the bed plus the slope of the free water depth. This is the slope of the free surface elevation. And in the same way, with respect to y, theta, theta, y plus h y. As you can observe here, you have not only one slope. In one dimensional model, we referred to the slope of the river by means of a bed slope, EB. Now we used the gradient of the bed. Is a vector with two slopes, one along the x-axis and one along the y-axis. So they are not the same. We cannot describe the slope of the bottom by means of only one number. We need two numbers. One is the slope along the x-direction and one is the slope along the y-direction. And in the same way, also the slope of the water depth, so as the water depth changes with space, can be written as the variation along the x-axis and the variation along the y-direction, the x-direction and y-direction. So, we can use this relation to solve, and now is the time to solve them, the momentum equation along x and along y. So now is the time to solve the x momentum equation. So the momentum equation written along the direction, the horizontal direction x. y plus v the zeta is equal to minus 1 over L rho the P x plus mu rho U. Instead of using this one, we need to use rho G the zeta W the x. Indeed, instead of dp in the x, we need to use this one. So, this equation becomes the u the t plus u the x plus v the u the y plus w in the, sorry, this is u and this is U in the zeta, U in the zeta equal to minus G rho and rho can be the zeta W the X plus mu over rho lambda squared U. Now we can observe that if we use U E is equal to U if E is equal to 1, V if E is equal to 2, and W if E is equal to 3. It's just a change of notation. If I perform this UEUJ dx, just for example, this is equal to UEUJ dx plus UJ UEUJ. So you can observe that this term, and this term are all of this form. So we can write these terms as the derivative of the product minus one of the derivative. So we can rewrite once again this one. So this is the same. This part is the derivative of this velocity times this velocity. It is u squared. So this is the derivative of u squared over the x. Actually, I don't need of the parentheses. So I can write this one as u squared minus one term here. So minus u to x plus, we can this one plus, oh sorry, the u the y minus, here we have v the u, then we u the y plus this term v, the derivative of u with respect to zeta. So we have plus the u the zeta minus u the zeta is equal to minus g the zeta w the x plus mu over rho nabla squared u. Now this one and this one are all multiplied for u. Then we can write the u in the t plus the squared u dx plus the u dy plus the u dz plus u du dx plus the u dy plus the w dz uguale equal to minus g the zeta w dx plus mu over rho nabla squared u. Now you can observe that this one, after this is a minus, this one is the continuity equation. Then this one is equal to zero. Pay attention that this is not neglected, is equal to zero, because this is the continuity equation. So finally the equation, the momentum equation along the x-axis is equal to the u in the t plus the u squared the x plus u the y plus the u w the theta is equal to minus g the zeta w x plus mu over rho nabla squared u. In the same way, without to repeat the computation, along x we have the u the t plus the plus the v squared the y plus the v the theta equal to minus g the theta w the y plus mu over rho w squared v. So these are different forms of the same equations that we have written before, exactly the same. So we cannot use, now we need to integrate these equations along the vertical axis, along the vertical direction, between the elevation of the bottom and the elevation of the surface. Of course, we need to integrate both of them, but we can make the computations only for x. Indeed, the y will be almost the same. Now, we need to write down the integral between theta b and theta w, the t, the theta, plus the integral the theta, theta, w, the u squared, the x, the theta, plus zeta b, zeta w, the derivative of u, v, the y, the theta, plus theta b, theta w, derivative of u, w, the theta, the zeta, equal to minus the integral zeta b zeta u g the t the x the theta theta u plus mu over rho the integral zeta b zeta w this one. Now, as you can understand, we need to perform a lot of computation right now. So we need, as before, the first one, the second one, the third one, and the fourth one. And just to understand, we can left hand side, il membro di sinistra, volete il primo membro dell'equazione. Is equal to 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. Whilst here we have 5 and here we have 6. So the right hand side is equal to 5 plus 6. And of course the equation is the left hand side is equal to the right hand side. Okay, so we need to perform a series of computation. Let's start with the first one. The integral between theta b, theta w, the u, the t, the theta. But we know that the Leibniz again rule can be used to write this one, theta b, theta w, u, theta, is equal to the integral zeta b zeta w of the derivative of u with respect to t zeta is plus the u at the free surface for the zeta u the time plus sorry minus u b, that is the horizontal component at the bottom, the zeta b with respect to time, that is equal to zero, because the bottom is fixed. Then we can write the left hand side is equal. As this is the first one, that is this one, the first one is equal to this term, then we can write here t dt between zeta t, zeta w, u, zeta, so we have this one, minus this term, sorry, minus u at the phase of phase, the derivative of the phase of phase solution with respect to time. Okay? Then we need to perform the second, and if we come back here, this one, but again, we have to compute zeta t, zeta w, the derivative of the squared u with respect to x in the zeta. But we know again for the Leibniz rule that d in the x zeta d zeta w of u squared the zeta is equal to zeta d zeta w d squared u in the x the zeta plus u squared at the free surface d zeta v d x minus u squared at the bottom the derivative of zeta p with respect to x, that is the slope of the bed along the x direction. But this is our term, so again we can write plus derivative with respect to x in d zeta y u the zeta minus u s derivative s squared the derivative of this one the x plus u squared at the bottom the derivative of b with respect to x plus. Then we need to write the third term, the third one. We can, if we come back, is this one. So again zeta b zeta w derivative u v the y the zeta. Again Leibniz rule. Then the derivative the y integral zeta b zeta w u v the zeta is equal to zeta b zeta w the derivative of u v the y that is the same in the zeta. But here we need to perform u at the free surface times v at the free surface d zeta u in the y plus minus u at the bottom v at the bottom d zeta bottom in the y. Again another slope. So we can write here plus the y integral zeta p zeta u the theta minus u at the free surface v at the free surface the zeta v the y plus u at the bottom the zeta p the y plus we can do it. Okay, we have the last term, that is this one. So again 3 and 4, the integral between zeta b zeta w the derivative of u zeta is equal. In this case we don't need the Leibniz rule because this integration is very simple. So this is equal to u between the free surface, or better, the bottom and the free surface. So this is equal to u at the free surface, v at the free surface between zeta p, minus u at the bottom, v at the bottom. But We know that UFS, the velocity at the free surface, we have to come back here, the velocity at the free surface is governed by the kinematic boundary condition at the free surface. Then we can write these terms. Then we need to come here and we need to write the zeta u, the t plus u at the free surface, the zeta w the x plus u at the free surface, the zeta w the y. Okay, and this is the first term. Plus minus UV times the vertical velocity at the bottom. If again we come back here, in this case, the vertical velocity at the bottom is governed by the kinematic boundary condition at the bottom. So we can use this relationship in order to express the velocity at the bottom. Again, we come here and we can write the zeta t, the x, sorry, I forgot, this is u, b, the zeta, b, the x, plus u, b, the zeta, b, the y. Actually, this is equal, so 4 is equal to, we need to perform this one, UFS, the zeta w the t, plus UFS squared, UFS squared, the zeta w the x, plus UFS, UFS, the zeta w, the y. And this is UFS times this term. Minus, then plus, minus, UV squared, squared, the zeta v, the x. Minus, UV. U, B, the Z, B, the Y. Then we can use this relationship and we can add to the here, then plus, plus U, F, S, the Z, W, the T. Then plus UFS squared the zeta u the x plus UFS UFS w the zeta w the x plus minus okay minus u b squared d z b d x minus u b v d d z b d y. We have finished. Then we can observe that here we have this one and this one. Then we have this one and this one. Then we have this one and this one, and then we have this one and this one, and finally I have finished the color, but I can use the white one. This one is equal to this one. So actually, the left hand side is not so complex because I have this one and this one, only three terms. and we can use the t zeta b zeta w to the zeta, that is this first term. Then we have the x zeta b zeta w u squared the zeta plus the y zeta b zeta w u the zeta. So we have used this one, and this one. Now, by considering u is a function of x and y and v, and of course of the time, and v, x, y and t. Note, pay attention, I'm not saying that the average velocity is not a function of the elevation. I'm saying that also the local velocity is not a function of the elevation. So not only we have an average velocity, but locally we have a velocity equal to the average value. So in this case, I need to write this one in the last here. If U and V are constant along the zeta, note along the zeta, of course, zeta. Note that these are local values. Then the left hand side, and this is the last thing we have to do, is equal to the derivative with respect to the time of the average value of the depth average velocity u plus the derivative with respect to x of the average value squared plus, of course, times h, times the derivative of u v h with respect to y. So again, we obtained an equation whose unknown are u, v, and h. Remember that within the frame of 2dH model, the solutions are u, the component of the depth average velocity along the x-axis, the component along the y-axis, and the water depth. And this is the left hand side. Now we need to write the right hand side, that is this one. So this one and this one. But it is not so complex to write the term 5. We can write here, because here we have 5 is is the integral of g, the derivative with respect to x. So the integral with the minus zeta w g the zeta u the x the zeta. But do you remember that zeta v is a function of x, y and t alone, not of zeta? Then this derivative is not so complex to perform, because we have this one, the x, times the integral of d zeta, that is zeta, between zeta b and zeta v, zeta w. Then this is equal
I can write equal minus g the zeta w the x zeta u minus zeta b. That is the water depth. So 5 is equal to minus gh the zeta w the
In sorry. Sì, ok. So this is 5. So So we can write the right hand side. We can start to write the right hand side as minus gh the zeta the x. Okay? Now the last term. The last term, if you remember, is zeta e zeta w of mu over rho number squared u. And this is not a simple term to solve. We need of a kind of a closure equation. And usually we can refer to the eddy viscosity. So instead of use the dynamic viscosity, we use a kind of macro description of the viscosity, so indeed the lateral transfer of momentum, but I think that it is a too detailed description, so we can simply write this term as the difference of the stress acting on the free surface minus the stress acting on the bottom, of course, the component along the x-axis. Now, just from a physical point of view, this could be, just for example, could be related to the wind action. So, if a wind acts on the free surface, we can take into account the effect of the wind action on the free surface by using this stress, but usually this stress can be neglected. Here we have the so-called bottom friction. But do you remember the bottom friction, just for example, that we express it within the frame of 1D model? In the 1D model, as you remember, the friction factor is tau 0 over gamma, the specific weight of water, and the hydraulic radius. Okay? Now we are writing a kind of equation in this case. Can write this. Here we have the bottom, and here we have the free surface. So here we have bottom, and here we have free surface. Think to this direction as x, and of course this direction as y, and this direction as z. Of course, the momentum equation governs what is happening along this direction. So actually, we are taking into account a wetted area, that is, oh sorry, this one. This one is the wetted area. Try to call this extension the y. Okay? So this is the wet area, and of course the height of this water column is the water depth. So omega is equal to the y times age. Okay? The wetted parameter is only this part. So the wetted parameter is equal to the y. So the hydraulic radius, that is omega over p, is equal actually to h. Then in this relationship, hull is equal to tau 0 over this one. Now we can resolve to, just for example, the expression of chassis in order to write this one. Okay, so this one, tau 0, actually is tau b now, tau b over the specific weight and the water depth. Indeed, here we have the component of the stress at the bottom, so the x component. So actually this is a vector, and here we need to write the intensity of this vector. So this is a vector. Now we can go here again, and we can write that tau b vector is equal to j specific weight a. How we can write j? But again, we can write j by using the same how we can write j? By using chassis as a first approximation, a rough approximation, but we can use chassis. Indeed, chassis, together with Strickler, say us that yes, j this one, but the hydraulic radius is h. So we have j is equal to squared u over ks squared h 4 power 4 over 3. But by using this relationship, we can resort to the values of the intensity of tau b. So the intensity of tau b is equal to j ks squared h power 4 over 3 rho g h, that is equal to rho g over k s squared h 4 over 3 minus 1, that is 1 over 3 u squared. Now, this U is the intensity of the vector velocity, okay? And now, the last thing, we need to write tau b, it is tau b, the component along the vector, along the x-axis, time the intensity of the velocity, that is u squared plus v squared, and in the same thing, by is equal tau b times v and the time velocity. Then, as a final relationship, we can write that tau bx is equal, we have to resolve to this relation, so it is okay, is equal to rho g over k s squared h 1 over 3, that is this one, Then we need to multiply for a square, for the square of the velocity, that is u, the velocity, u plus u squared. Note that u could be also negative with respect to the x direction. So this one act in one direction on one the tau b always react to the flow, and in the same way tau b y is equal to log g k s h 1 over 3 u squared plus u squared. Then we've written we started from here, this part. So simply here we can write minus tau bx, where tau bx is this one. Okay? Now we need to write LHS equal to LHS, and we have finished. So if we come back, we need to write this one equal to the last results that we have achieved. So we have the derivative of UH with respect to the time plus the derivative of U squared with respect to X plus the derivative of uv, the derivative with respect to y, is equal, and this is the left hand side, but I forgot the word that here and here, is equal to this one, minus g h derivative of theta w over minus tau b x. Okay, now, and this is along the x direction, we can again write that the theta b x is equal to the x h plus theta b. So this equation actually is equal to this one plus the derivative squared h x plus this one u h y plus g the derivative with respect to h with respect to x, that is this part, of course here we have also this one, minus plus g h the zeta b the x plus tau b x is equal to q. Then along the x-axis we have a time derivative u h the t plus a derivative with respect to x. Oh, sorry. A derivative with respect to x, that is this one, so u squared h, u squared h, plus we have also this one, but this one is equal to the derivative with respect to x of 1 over 2 g h squared. Indeed, if you perform the derivative of this term with respect to x, you have 2 gh dh with respect to x. So here we can write plus 1 over 2 gh squared plus a derivative with respect to y, and here we have only this term. This term, that is UH, and then we have a kind of parameters. Indeed, this one is the slope of the slope of the bottom along the x direction. So we can write here plus gh theta e with respect to x plus tau b. This is a last term, is equal to zero. This is the long x. If you repeat the same computation, we obtain the same shape, the same form of the equation. 2h dt plus dx of uvh plus the derivative with respect to y of u squared h plus 1 over 2gh squared plus gh the zeta b the y plus tau b y is equal to 0. As you can see here, you have a derivative, but just before, let's try to write also the continuity equation here. Continuity equation. We need to start from before. Here you have dh with respect to the time, a derivative with respect to the x, and a derivative with respect to the y. So you can write here again dh dt plus derivative with respect to x uh plus the derivative with respect to y of uh is equal to 0. Now, if this is the first equation, this is the second equation, and this is the third equation, actually all these equations can be written as the summation of four terms. The first one is a derivative of a vector u over t plus a derivative of another vector in the x plus a derivative of another vector with respect to y plus a vector that is not derived. Then u is, we need to refer here, in the first equation the derivative of h is on the water depth, then the first term is water depth. This one is u times h. The second one is u times h. And then this is u. This u. A is equal to u h. This term. Here we have u squared h. Plus 1 over 2 g h squared, and the second one is this one u v h. F is equal to u v h and v squared h plus 1 over 2 g. Okay, and the last one, S, is equal to the remaining terms, that are here 0, we have not other terms, 0. So the second equation is gh the zeta b the x, g, oh sorry, is gh the zeta b the x plus
tau dx, and here we have gh dz b dy plus tau dy. Then, and the last one, we have written the final equation in this way. U derived with respect to t, A derived with respect to x, F derived with respect to y, plus S is equal to 0, where U, A, F, and S are these vectors, and this equation, after these equations, can be solved by means of numerical methods. Now, the next lecture, we will repeat the physical significance of these obtained equations, and then we talk about the numerical methods.